I would like to thank Peter and Molly and Sean for making it possible for me to be here. Not really for the opportunity to speak, but more like for the fact that I'm having the benefit of all these important discussions. I couldn't imagine not being here. So thank you very much. Now, I wanted to take a subject matter that is really a challenge to intellectual property and human rights intersection. And I had the privilege of sitting on a panel where we discussed Larry's book. And also, I've had the opportunity of reading a lot of recent literature on IP and human rights. And one issue that strikes me is how to frame indigenous people's rights into the context of IP and human rights. Well, you could say human rights is universal, but the experience of indigenous peoples are such that it is not universal to them. They struggle to have a space in the human rights discussion. And so, we should not presume. And the same struggle they have with intellectual property rights as well. So it's not a presumption that they are part of the conversation. And so I figured that the best way to start is to look at all these rights we're talking about. Intellectual property rights. They are rights incidental to knowledge production. Human rights are recognized as inherent and inalienable. They are incidents of being human for the realization of our human potential. What about indigenous people's rights? We're talking about tradition-based knowledge and innovation systems that are part of environmental stewardship, economic, social, and cultural identity, and self-determination of people and their worldviews. So when you put these three rights together in what I call this trilogy of rights, you recognize that human rights activate a significant degree of indigenous people's rights as well as intellectual property rights. But then the issue of framing indigenous people's rights within the intersection between human rights and intellectual property is really a conceptual challenge. And the reason is this. Across basic human rights literature and instruments, there's lack of clarity on indigenous people's rights, especially in the International Bill of Rights. And Peter, you have said, and I believe in that, when these rights were constructed, they never had indigenous peoples in mind. And the same is true when we began to think about intellectual property rights. We never had the process of knowledge production in non-Western societies in mind. And another point is this. Just as we have been talking about rights to health, rights to access to medicine, to food, we cannot really talk about indigenous people's rights within the head of any of the conventional human rights or even intellectual property rights. And the point here is that indigenous people's rights constitute a source of irritation to both human rights and intellectual property rights. Human rights and intellectual property rights are heavily weighted in favor of individualism. Whenever we talk about indigenous people's rights, there's a tendency to think about collective or group rights. And for indigenous peoples caught within this intersection, the point here is that, as Larry and Graham have said, there is a tendency to claim to IP protection and also to claim to be protected from intellectual property rights. And that is really the problem with indigenous peoples and their dialectical relationship with IP. So why do I have to struggle with mapping out indigenous people's rights within the intersection of human rights and intellectual property? It will help us to really unveil the root of indigenous people's disadvantages in both legal domains as victims of discrimination and exclusion and outliers in Western legal tradition. So it's also an opportunity as well to reinvigorate indigenous people's rights discourse with some sense of reflection as opposed to basic presumptions we are bound to make. And the point that strikes me most is that not all indigenous claims are intellectual property related. Not all of them are human rights either. But when we combine them, it provides us a bigger picture. And perhaps human rights could help fill some gaps that intellectual property has left when it concerns indigenous peoples. And also, the human rights IP intersection provides us a mirror for viewing the progress of human rights and, to some extent, intellectual property rights. So I have three frameworks to walk through how the indigenous people's conversation appear to be getting into the human rights intellectual property intersection. The progress has not been significant, but symbolic, and that's what I have found. If you look at the International Bill of Rights, starting with the Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, you could see obviously that indigenous people's expectations are less problematic, at least in the 20th to 21st century. But yet, there is a problem regarding the issue of self-determination. The peopleness of indigenous peoples has always been a problem. Earlier treaties had always treated them as populations, and consequently, they would not be entitled to self-determination. Okay, when you look at the Covenant on Economic and Social and Cultural Rights, there is no special accommodation of indigenous peoples except for references to diverse categories of discrimination. That is when indigenous issues are activated, either by way of race, religion, circumstances of birth, social origin, servitude, and forced labor. But my observation is that the density of rights under the economic, social, and cultural rights implicate a corresponding concentration of indigenous claims. Then the second framework would be the specific treaty instruments. And I begin with the International Labour Organization, the Convention number 107 of 1957. That is the one that called indigenous and tribal peoples and tribal populations convention. And we made some little progress. In 1989 or so it was, Convention number 169 talked about indigenous and tribal peoples convention. Now, it began to recognize that these are no longer population, but they are tribal peoples. But they are no longer population, but they are peoples. But then there is a fixation on the so-called external self-determination. So they were recognized as peoples, but they could not be candidates for self-determination. Yet, it wasn't a major step forward. But lately, UNESCO has provided yet another platform. UNESCO is a player in both human rights and indigenous people's rights. And we can count to date about 7 important treaties dealing with different aspects of culture of indigenous peoples, their knowledge systems, and self-determination in the context of a diffusion of global cultural diversity. And so, WIPO is yet another organization taking into cognition the Intergovernmental Committee and other relevant treaties. What we see now is a shifting view from indigenous or traditional knowledge from the narrow lens of intellectual property to equitable diffusion of benefits. And that has some implications for human rights. In the environmental platform, we have the CBD and the Rio instruments and the process of access and benefit sharing, and lately the Nagoya Protocol and farmers' rights under the International Treaty for Protection of Plant Genetic Resources. And so there are other conventions on racial discrimination, discrimination against women, and the rights of children. And the General Comments have tried to really work very hard to expand the interpretations of these instruments to accommodate indigenous peoples. And more importantly, the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples elaborates on applications of human rights in the specific cultural, historical, and socio-economic circumstances of indigenous peoples. It's become proactive in relation to Article 31, talking about indigenous peoples' rights and intellectual property. And it helps us to lay to rest and to bury, possibly, any lingering reservations we might have in regard to indigenous people's entitlement to self-determination. And that instrument links self-determination with human rights, with indigenous people's rights, and as well as with intellectual property rights. Now, we can recognize some degree of shifting interest in the context of indigenous people's rights. The TRIPS agreement was one significant step downwards. Indigenous peoples, just like most disadvantaged members of the global population, we are vulnerable and they remain vulnerable to the expansion and tightening of global intellectual property regimes. Yet, the issue of indigenous people's rights also constitutes part of sites for counteracting the expansion of intellectual property through the TRIPS agreement. Now, the most important way through which indigenous people's rights appear to be coming into the intellectual property human rights intersection would seem to be through the work of the Committee on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights. In 2001, this document called Human Rights and Intellectual Property was designed to identify some of the key human rights principles deriving from the covenant, which are required to be taken into account in the development, interpretation, and implementation of contemporary intellectual property regimes. And so this was a landmark document. And further down the road, the committee began to elaborate on certain significant aspects of, particularly through General Comment Number 17 of 2005. It talks about authors and talks about groups of persons. It talks about moral rights as a right that will accrue to groups and communities. And also, we have today how corporations are not candidates to some of those rights. But yet, we have this problem. If indigenous groups decide to activate their creative potentials through a corporate vehicle, it becomes a major challenge. But at least the first impression of that interpretation was seemingly friendly to indigenous group inclinations. And so, scientific, literary, and artistic production has been expanded to include knowledge, innovations, and practices of indigenous and local communities. And this interpretative scheme goes to endorse alternative means for protection of moral rights. And then it has outlined significant state obligations to ensure protection of indigenous interest in knowledge production. And that will also be subject to indigenous preferences. It sanctions registration and anti-appropriation measures, the promotion of individual or collective authorship, the concept of free prior informed consent, collective administration of rights, equitable access through cost-reducing measures, scientific and technological progress is designed, according to this interpretation, must always be designed to serve human rights. So I'll begin to wind down by making some reflections. The interest of the Committee on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights on human rights and IP would seem to be belated. The previous or the pre-2001 general comments, particularly the one on the right to food and the right to education, were issued outside the 2001 principles. But yet we know that food and education are sites for indigenous innovation and creativity and the extension of scientific, literary, and artistic production. And so when these principles were laid down, they did not actually factor in what indigenous peoples did, and it was not driven by the 2001 principles. But in the meantime, the General Comment has elaborated on significant areas where indigenous peoples' rights are implicated. So in contrast, after 2001, the general comments reflect the committee's proactive engagement with human rights and intellectual property in recognition of those principles. For example, General Comments 17 and 21, the right to benefit from moral and material interest and the right to take part in the cultural life, they were all developed after the 2001 principles. And so what do we take from this? Core international human rights instruments make no direct reference to indigenous people's rights. So, the accommodation of indigenous people's rights appear mainly in secondary interpretative instruments of weak juridical status. Now, after 2001, there is now growing recognition of indigenous people's rights as groups' rights requiring special protection. The key instruments encourage protection of traditional knowledge within existing intellectual property rights paradigm. However, the approach of these instruments to protectable subject matter recognize that indigenous people's rights transcend intellectual property and activate diverse human rights concerns and therefore require pragmatic responses. Intellectual property is a problem as well as a potential solution to the realization of indigenous people's rights. And so why it is important to engage with this subject? It is a major opportunity to begin to understand how the intellectual property system has continuously put a heavy boot on the head of indigenous people's rights. And on the other hand, how the human rights framework had never been in its historical evolution sensitive to indigenous people's peculiarities. And so I will conclude by saying that human rights encounter with intellectual property can be measured meaningfully by focusing on its ramification for indigenous peoples as the most vulnerable members of the human family. And I'm quoting Larry and Graham. After all, the realization of human rights must be judged according to the level of implementation among the most disadvantaged. And I think this is really why it is a mission to begin now that it is really fairly new to think about the intersection of intellectual property and human rights to see how we can actually create a discursive space for indigenous people's rights. Thank you.